praise God.
How many remembers what we taught on last Sunday?
Sleeping.
Prayer. Amen. See, I did.
Jesus said, sleep on.
Sleep on. Amen. We weren't the only ones that had a problem with that, was it? Disciples did too. Amen. Prayer. We're just going to continue on with that this morning. We're talking about life, a life of prayer. We're talking about the difference between a life of prayer and a prayer life. Does anybody remember the difference between those two? Anybody? It's all right if you don't. I understand. But anyways, a prayer life refers to, you know, like you say, your time, like if you're devoted to an hour or whatever, 30 minutes a day, that's your prayer life. But a life of prayer, you turn it around, it's like New Testament is talking about the scripture we read, like praying always. Pray without ceasing. You know, we know we're just going to continue to be on our knees all day long. That's not what he's talking about, but having our mind and our attitude focused upon prayer. And it always being on our minds. Maybe you know different ones. You know, you may hear them all throughout the day. Thank you, Jesus. Or praise God. It's because they got a mind of praying. And that's what he's referring to, and that's what we're going to continue on this morning with, a life of prayer. And then probably next Sunday we'll go to a prayer life. I don't know how long we'll go. But anyway, how many knows prayer is important this morning? Yeah. Amen. I thought about it this week as I was thinking on prayer and thinking on Sunday school. You know, the devil wouldn't fight praying if he knew it wasn't powerful. Amen. The devil wouldn't fight it if he knew it didn't work. The problem is this morning, the devil knows that prayer works. He knows that. And that's why that he fights us so severely on praying. That's why the devil likes to fill our lives with so much stuff that we don't have time to pray. Because he knows that prayer works. It's just been proven over and over and over that, hey, prayer really works. Amen. Don't you believe that this morning? I know we all probably got our stories of some time when we prayed and, you know, and the circumstances changed. We all have those times. We all have those places in our life that really stick out in our minds that when we prayed, something happened, something changed. And, I'm glad for that this morning. I'm glad that we can call out to heaven, aren't you? Amen. You know, I always think about these folks that worship false images, worship false gods. You know, those gods can't answer not one of those prayers, can they? They can't do nothing for us. Amen. But it's so much different whenever we worship someone that is alive, that's sitting on the throne this morning, that we can pray to, that hears our prayers and can answer them. I know sometimes we feel like God don't ever hear our prayers. You ever felt that way? Amen. But, you know, always remember that God hears our prayers. He just don't always answer them when I want them. Amen. Prayer. Exodus chapter 25. Turn there if you would. Verse number 13. When you have it, say amen. Amen. And thou shalt make staves of shittim wood, overlay them with gold. And thou shalt put the staves into the rings by the sides of the ark, that the ark may be borne with them. If you're not looking at it, they're borne, B-O-R-N-E, is talking about as they carry them with it. And verse number 15, the staves shall be the rings, in the rings of the ark. They shall not be taken from it. That's all I'm going to read from there. Just so you know, if you're not familiar with this morning, it's talking about the Ark of God. How many remembers the Ark of the Lord in the Old Testament? It talks about a lot. And these staves were the I don't know what you call them, the whatever they carried, the ark of God. They carried it with us. What they set it on their shoulders and walked with it, went through the rings on the four corners of the ark. That's what it's talking about there. And it said there in verse 15, they shall not be taken from it. Now you may be, well, how in the world can this be important with prayer? Let me explain that this morning. The Ark of the Covenant was a symbolic of God's glory, of God's Spirit that they carried with them. I remember, I'm sitting here trying to think of the man's name in the Old Testament where the Philistines had come in and stole the ark. And one of the messengers went and told him, said, hey, your sons has died. That didn't faze him as bad. Anybody remember his name? Sorry if you don't. Anyways, but whenever they told him that, hey, the Philistines had stole the ark of God, the Spirit of God from us, he fell over and died. Anyways, I was sitting trying to think of his name. Bothering me. Anyways, but what bothered him was the most was because the Spirit of God had departed from them. It was stolen from them, from the enemy. And he died from that. Because it bothered him so bad. And you know, it should be the same way with us this morning. If we don't feel God's Spirit, if we don't have God's Spirit dwelling with us, it should bother us that bad. Amen. But it was symbolic of God's glory is what the Ark of God was. Jehovah sat on the mercy seat that was on the top of the Ark. It was a well-known fact that wherever the Ark was, God's hand would mightily be present. Think about the story of David. You know, when he was bringing the Ark of God in, and he brought it in on a new cart, the Bible said. They wasn't transporting it by these staves that God had made. This, you know, this is the way God wanted his Spirit to be transported. Well, they thought, well, we'll make it a little easier. We'll put it on a new cart. We'll let some donkeys pull it. Well, that didn't work, did it? That's not what God said do. And then it went to fall, and Uzzah, was that his name? Or
yeah.
Uzziah, one of them. Anyways, he put his hand on it to steady the ark, and God struck him dead. And then it upset David, and he set the ark aside in Obed-Edom's house. Yeah. He set it aside, and it went on. And then you know what? He got word back that Obed-Edom was being blessed because of the Spirit of God. He said, you know what? I got to go get it. So wherever the Spirit, the Ark of God was, God's hand was mightily present. God was blessing. Amen. God blesses where His Spirit is. Amen. I want God's Spirit to dwell with me, don't you?
Yeah.
Amen. At times, Israel's enemies would fret going to war with them because they knew the Ark was there. They didn't always like going up against Israel because they knew the ark was there. They knew they had God on their side. Amen. And we know we can't win against God, can we? Amen. I want God forever on my side, don't you? The staves were significant. They were long poles that were inserted through the four rings, I've already said this morning, fastened to the four corners of the ark. The staves were used to carry the ark. This awesome task of bearing the ark was given to the Kohathites. Kohath was the son of Levi. Throughout the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament, the people of God were without a permanent place of worship, without a tabernacle. They worshiped in a tent that we refer as a tabernacle. God in the form of a cloud by day and a fire by night. Maybe you read the Old Testament. You remember all these stories as God had led them. The tabernacle was pitched wherever the people of God camped. The staves, or those long poles, were to never to be taken out of the rings of the ark, because the ark was never permanently settled. So they were always to remain in the ark. They weren't to remove those poles. That's where they stayed, because they were always on the move. Camp here one night, move here to the next night. So they never removed them. It was continuously on the move. This is in 1 Kings chapter 8, if you ever want to go back and read about it. But 400 years of the Kohathites carried the Ark of God from one campsite to the next. When Solomon's temple was completed, the Ark of God was permanently moved into the holies of holies. Let's imagine that day. Excuse me. The Kohathites transported the Ark into the court of Solomon's temple. They've been carrying it for years. And now they're carrying it. They're finally a resting place for God's Spirit. They transported it into the courts of Solomon's temple. As they approached the court, they beheld the priest awaiting them. The Kohathites were not permitted to enter in to the holies of holies. So they transferred the Ark into the shoulders of the priest, because the priest was the only ones that was allowed to go in into the where the Ark was to be placed. So they give it to the priest. The priest took the burden of the Ark, proceeded into the innermost chambers of God's holy sanctuary. They settled the Ark and the mercy seat into the appointed place. Then they reached down and pulled the staves partly out of the Ark's rings. At first, the staves could be seen sticking out from underneath the veil, but they turned at 90-degree angle to prevent that from sticking out. Maybe you can picture this in your mind this morning. The partial removal of the staves, the poles, you could say, they pulled them out a little ways, conveyed, it made a statement that the Ark found a permanent resting place. Amen. They also served as guides for the high priest to ensure that he would locate the exact place where he entered in once a year to sprinkle the blood and to offer the incense before the Ark, which otherwise might be mistaken in a dark place. So there were several different reasons why they had done that. But there are two types of Christians represented here. And I'm going to tell you the importance of why I told you all that. You know, as they removed the poles, the staves, partially, because it represented that the Ark now has a resting place to stay. Two types of Christians represented. The Christian whose heart is like Moses' tabernacle. The saint whose heart is compared to Solomon's temple. The Ark, the glory of God, comes to them, but it's not permanently settled. Amen. They never remove the staves, the poles, you could say. There seems to always be something that hinders them from capturing the anointing and walking in it continually. Their heart is enlightened for a season, but they soon return to their former state. In 1 Corinthians 6 and 19, he says, "What, know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God. Ye are not your own." Amen. So where should that temple come to that resting place at? Right here. Amen. He said it. Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Amen. How often we claim the infilling of the Holy Ghost, yet the presence of the Holy Ghost is not upon us spiritually today, but carnal tomorrow, on the mountain today, in the valley tomorrow, impressed this week, depressed next week. Does that sound familiar this morning? And Paul, he said in Galatians 5 and 16, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit." Amen. Praise God. Amen. It's not meant for us to be here today, in the morning, down here, up and down. I remember there's a book, I haven't got to read it, but I remember the title of it. It said, "Stop the Merry-Go-Round." Stop going around and around, up and down today. Amen. If we live in the Spirit, we'll also walk in it. Christians can be divided into two categories this morning. Christians who pray and walk in the Spirit, and those that do not pray and are prone to carnality. One may think this is impossible to be a Christian and not walk in the Spirit. But don't be deceived this morning. There's been many people been invited into the pulpit simply because they're good orators. I heard a statement this week, kind of made me laugh a little bit. Said the one man invited them to preach, said, "You know what, I've never heard you preach and don't care how you preach, but I know your grandpa was good." I said, "Wow." Amen. It's not the way it ought to be. Amen. It's not just because how good we are, how good some of our kinfolks are. Amen. But it boils down to how good my relationship is with Christ. Amen. Rather, I'm walking in the Spirit. Praise God. If we live in the Spirit, we're going to walk in the Spirit. Praise God. Where are we walking at this morning? What's the path that you and I are on this morning? Amen. Are we walking in the Spirit? Praise God. Amen. I want to walk after God's Spirit, don't you? Amen. We wonder why revival does not last, but the answer is simple and very obvious. People have a sporadic prayer lives and have hearts and minds that are not absorbed in the Spirit, that are like the Moses' temple. You know, it's always on the move. The staves are still in place. They have not been partially removed to represent a resting spot. Amen. We have to come to that place in our life where it's not just something that us periodically do, I pray, once a week. It's something that it's become a resting place within me. It's something that whenever I do daily, amen, that I pray, that I seek God. Praise God, because God's Spirit is indwelling in my temple. Amen. Does that make sense to you this morning? I hope it does. Revival moves some in the present tense. During the revival, they are touched by the Spirit, inspiration. While the Spirit is moving, they set themselves to pray. Often, enlightened the soul resolves to pray an hour, perhaps 2 hours a day or whatever. But after the revival is ended, they are faced with a challenge of maintaining that prayer life. Amen. I hope it's a help us this morning. It's not just while we're at church. It's not just, you know what, it's Sunday. I need to get up Sunday in the morning and pray. But you know what, it's Monday in the morning. I still need to get up and pray. It's Tuesday and I still need to get up and pray. Praise God, it don't matter if it's church, just church time. That's just a place that we come to draw from God. But our truly living, our truly walking in the Spirit is at home. Amen. That's where it counts at this morning. Praise God, is our everyday life, that we have a prayer life, a life of prayer. Amen. It will make a difference in your home. I challenge you this morning to try it. Try to make sure that you have a life of prayer, a prayer life. And just see what it does in your home. Amen. I promise you, you'll see a major difference whenever you make a point to have a prayer life and a life of prayer. Praise God. You'll see things happen that you never thought would happen. How do you know that? Amen. Because I've seen it in my own self. Praise God. Amen. I know myself. If I miss one day for whatever reason, that really bothers me. I don't like missing that prayer time with God. Why? Because that's where we draw our strength at, spiritually. Amen. That's where we glean from God. We can't do it unless we're in prayer, unless we're studying God's Word. That's how we grow. Amen. A tree's not going to grow if it don't ever get watered, is it? A tree grows by the water. It bears fruit by the water that it's fed, by the nutrients that it gets. If it doesn't get any nutrients, it's going to shrivel up and die. I was reading about that this morning in Mark, where Jesus walked by that tree. The Bible said that he was hungry and he come by a fig tree, didn't have nothing on it, so he cursed that fig tree. The next day, they was coming back by it, and the disciples noticed it. Man, that tree's withered up. So they asked Jesus about it. Amen. You know what? When Christ comes by, He wants to see some fruit on our trees, don't He? Amen. He don't like it whenever we ain't producing. Amen. And without water, without nutrients, we're not going to produce. Without praying, without the Word of God, we're not going to be what we need to be. Amen. Is that all right this morning? Praise God. We will be a better person. We will have a better family. We'll have a better church whenever we make sure we get a hold of a prayer life, a life of prayer. Amen. That it's something that's not just sporadic, periodically, but something that is continually that we're doing. Amen. But because that many are not willing to pull the staves, to pull the poles from the ark, according to its nature, the glory of God moves. Amen. Waiting for the tabernacle, minding your heart this morning to settle again. Amen. Praise God. God is waiting on us this morning to settle, you could say. Amen. That He can rest upon us with His Spirit. Praise God. Don't you want God's Spirit to dwell within you this morning? Amen. Let's make sure He has a settling place within us. Amen. That we're not always on the move. That He cannot settle in us. That He cannot work in us. Amen. The secret of the shadow. Did you think about this morning? Talks about in Acts chapter 5. We read about the immediate happenings after the Pentecost. How many remembers the day of Pentecost? Where the Holy Ghost came down. Yeah. Many were saved. What was it? 3,000 people were added to the church. Revival of mighty proportion broke out in the streets of Jerusalem. People from all over were bringing the sick to the apostles, hoping they and their relatives would be healed. The power of God was so great that every sickness, every disease was cured. The Bible tells us that many souls were added unto the church. Excuse me. This is an incredible story. Within it we find proof that we can possess the anointing of God so great that it penetrates the very room we occupy. You this morning can have the same walk with God that those that we read about in the Bible had. You believe that this morning? Everybody with me? We awake? Amen. We can have that same walk with God that they had. Acts chapter 5 and verse 15. Maybe you just want to flip over and read this with me. I hadn't noticed this before till studying this, but... He said, insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets. Now, he's talking about the revival that had broke out. They're bringing people to Him here in Acts chapter 5 and verse 15. Insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. Man, imagine that this morning. They're not just trying to touch Peter. They're not trying to get Peter to pray over them. They're just wanting his shadow from the light, from the sun, just to pass over them. The man of God's shadow falling upon the feet of the lame man was all that was needed to administer healing. People were coming from all over here. They were trying to find the right angle to where Peter's shadow was the longest. Just think about this in your own mind this morning. You'd better believe that Satan, just thinking, he might have tried to not let the sun shine where Peter was standing. Don't let no light get on Peter. We don't need his shadow going nowhere. I wonder if he tried to send clouds to block the sun rays from falling upon the streets of Jerusalem. What was the secret of Peter's shadow? Was his shadow special in some unknown way? Was there a particular healing balm coming from the sun at that time of the year. No, that wasn't what it was. These men and women were no different than any of us this morning. The secret of Peter's shadow was the heart he possessed. That was the secret to it. Was the heart that he possessed. Amen. He had a heart comparable to Solomon's temple. He possessed a life that was saturated with God's anointing. He had a heart that was free of Adam's apron of fig leaves. We talked about that last Sunday where Adam wrapped himself in the fig leaves. He had a heart that was free from the coas staves or their poles that they used that was continually on the move. He had a heart that allowed our great high priest this morning, Jesus Christ, to pull the poles out and let the anointing rest and abide upon his life. Amen. That's what I want this morning. Amen. I want the power of God to continually be upon us. Don't you? Amen. That was who Peter was. You know, we read the life of Peter. He wasn't a perfect man, was he? He did some wrong things. He betrayed Jesus Christ. But you know what? He wasn't like Judas who went out and hung himself. But the Bible said that he repented. He made things right. So you know what? This morning, you see where Peter's at now. This is in Acts. This ain't where Jesus was crucified. This is on after that. After he had denied him. So this tells us this morning that, hey, you know what? We can be free from our past. That we can be truly saved this morning. And God can truly use us. Don't you believe that this morning? Amen. But all of it relies in our hands this morning. It's up to us to be like Peter. And say, you know what, God, I'm going to make it right. I'm going to walk after you. That you can use me. Amen. We have to have that life that rests, that is settled, where God can settle in us. Amen. This shadow from the mercy seat. Let's go deeper in the secret of this shadow this morning. No one but a Levite was allowed to touch the Ark of the Covenant. Let's think about the verse in Psalms 91 and verse 1. He said, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Praise God. This is a very interesting passage that reveals in more detail the secret of the shadow. As David writes these words, you must realize that David was not a Levite, okay? The Levites were the only ones that could go in. No one but a Levite was allowed to touch the Ark of the Covenant. David was not a Levite. He was from the tribe of Judah. Because he was of Judah and not Levite, he was not permitted to touch the Ark of the Covenant. David would pitch a tent over the Ark during bad weather, but when the sun was shining, they removed the tent. The Ark was exposed for all to see. Though the Scriptures do not say it in plain words, it is implied that David would wait until the sun was shining upon the Ark. Amen. And lay down in its shadow. He may not have been able to touch the Ark, the glory of God, with his hands. He may not have been able to touch the wings of the cherubim or lay his fingers upon the mercy seat. But he could lay in its shadow and feel the glory penetrate his very soul. Amen. Makes me think about the woman with the issue of blood. She said, if I could but just touch the hem of his garment. If I could just get close to him. Just to feel his presence. Amen. Oh, what it would do to my soul. Think about this with David this morning. He couldn't touch the Ark. If I could just lay in the shadow of the Ark. Praise God. You know what? God is so mighty. If we could just pass by our way. Amen. It does mighty things.
Got a picture of that with Joshua. He stood in the tabernacle, Moses, inside the inner court.
Yeah.
The Lord, of course, God's presence was there, the light. Everything that went about with God coming down the middle of Moses. Joshua in the tabernacle came out here. The Bible said when Moses come out and he left, but the scripture said Joshua stood yet before the Lord.
Yeah.
He just stood there soaking up
the
presence of God.
Presence. Amen.
For us to get in that place. That's
getting in that place.
That's
right.
Right. Amen. Through prayer, we get into that place of getting in the presence of God. We may not be able to physically see Him this morning, but you know what? If we just feel His presence.
If prayer doesn't entice prayer in our heart, it shouldn't be prayer. That's what prayer is. It's preparation. It's prayer.
Yeah.
Get in the presence of God.
Right. Yeah. Amen. The Apostle Paul told the Corinthians that the born-again believer is the temple of God. We read a while ago. Again, our hearts are to be likened unto Solomon's temple, in which the Ark of the Covenant, the glory of God, rests continuously. Because we are the temple of God, the Ark of God is within us. As Christians operating under grace, we have the privilege of having the anointing of God upon our very heart and soul. Amen. Concerning Peter, when the sun shone upon him, those that were affected by his shadow were generally sinner men and women who could not touch the glory of God. When that man of God walked by the ark of God, God's tabernacle within his soul, his shadow fell upon the ground, permitting and penetrating those around him. Amen. The presence of God. I want to live in the presence of God, don't you? Amen. To dwell in it. Praise God. Can we not fathom the supernatural power of God's anointing being transferred from our bodies into something tangible such as a prayer cloth? You know, we've heard a lot. Maybe some of you have heard about it. We've done it many times. We pray, have a prayer cloth that maybe send home with somebody, send them to give to somebody. You may wonder about that. Acts chapter 19 and verse 12 says, so that from this body we were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the disease departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. May we comprehend the abundant blessing that befall the Christians who prepares the chambers of our hearts. Amen. Even as the widow did for Elijah, for the continual abiding of God's anointing. Smith Wigglesworth was preaching a revival meeting in a particular town. A member of that congregation offered to let Mr. Wigglesworth stay in her home. Wigglesworth slept in the bed that the generous woman's husband normally slept in. Her husband was unregenerated. He wasn't saved. She desperately prayed that Mr. Wigglesworth's godly influence would win him to the Lord. When the revival was finished, Mr. Wigglesworth packed his belongings and started to leave. The lady of the house began to sob and beg him to stay until her husband was converted. He continued his walk out the doors, but as he went to shut the door, he called back to her, just don't change the sheets. Just don't change the sheets. She didn't understand this until her husband laid down that night. He broke out in a cold sweat. He tossed and turned all night. His heart was pounding under conviction. Early in the morning, she could hear him crying to the Lord for salvation. Praise God. Amen. May we this morning walk in such a way we can call out to the desperate one, don't change the sheets. Amen. That we live a life that no matter where we're at, that we pray, that we continue to seek God, that God's Spirit is with us continually. Amen. He didn't have to go lay his hands on him, did he? He didn't have to go anoint him with oil. He just said, don't change the sheets. Man. Who was it? Was it Elijah or Elisha? When he was dead, they laid that man on his bones. Can't remember that full story. And he came back to life. Why was that? He was, you know, Elijah was a dead man. But it was because that he had a hope to the power of God. God's Spirit had rested upon him. He had removed the poles, so to speak. Amen. Of the Spirit of God. And it had a resting place upon him. The power of God is that real this morning. Don't you believe it? Amen. It's that real this morning. A few centuries past, there was a woman who was so godly and Christ-like. A sweet aroma lingered in the room after she was gone. We must be instant in season and out of season. Amen. We must have heart and mind that is continually fixed upon the Lord. We read that scripture last Sunday. My heart is fixed. Fixed on Thee, O Lord. Amen. Is your heart fixed this morning? I hope it's fixed upon God. Amen. A heart that is free from worldliness, free from vain thinking, free from the cares of this life. A heart that is stayed upon the Lord. Praise God. You see, this morning it's so much more than just Sunday morning and Wednesday night. Amen. It's so much more than just the appointed times. Praise God. But it is a daily walk with God. That's what Paul was saying when he said, praying always. Amen. Having a life of prayer. You know what life of prayer does? It produces a pure mind. 2 Peter 3 and 1, the second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds. The word pure is defined by Strong's dictionary as the sun's ray, judged by sunlight, tested as genuine, pure, sincere. Peter speaks of stirring up the pure mind there in 2 Peter 3 and 1. It literally means to be tried by the sunlight, the probing light of God's Spirit, inspecting, investigating, penetrating the most secret places. What do we do when we get out to pray? You know, David, he prayed that way. Oh, Lord, search me, oh God. Know my ways. Try my reins. He wanted God to know the very depths of his heart. That God would investigate him. That God would penetrate the most secret places. You have not been exposed until God exposes you. Man. Think about that this morning. We have not been exposed until God exposes us. I don't know everything this morning. I don't know everything everybody goes through. But God does. God knows the very depths of our hearts. He knows everything that we hide, everything that goes on in the secret places. God knows it, don't He? Amen. Praise God. God is Almighty this morning. We must have a pure mind. We hear many discussions concerning the saint having a pure heart. You know, we hear a lot about that. Having a pure heart. Having a pure heart. But very few of them having a pure mind. The heart, the seat of appetite and emotions, is not the first place that sin enters. It's not. Where does it always enter at? It is the mind that it attacks first. The enemy knows well that the war is won within the corridors of our mind. Amen. A very wise person once wrote the phrase, an idle mind is the devil's playground. That's a very true statement this morning. The devil knows if he can just get a hold of our mind, if he can just get us to think about it, just think about it for a little while. He knows what it'll do. Amen. It first enters the mind. The mind is an awesome tool given to us by God, isn't it? Amen. I'm glad for a mind this morning. I'm glad for it. You know, we have things today because people has used their mind that God has given them to create things, to have things that we can live. The mind is an awesome gift from God. Within the mind, a continual conversation takes place between the conscience, the flesh, the enemy, and God. Amen. Always. Amen. I know I ain't the only one this morning. The devil fights my mind. He fights all of us. Amen. To get us to think things that we shouldn't be thinking about. To get us to do things that we shouldn't be doing. Amen. With the mind, a continual conversation between the conscience, the flesh, the enemy, and God. Much reasoning power has been given to the human mind, but sin perverts man's ability to reason. Sin messed that up. When this is relentless conversation requires judgment, often the wrong decision is made and self-inflicted pain and suffering befalls us, comes upon us because we wrestled it in our minds and we made the wrong decision. And it's got us in all kinds of trouble because of that. The man writing this book, he put an illustration in here. Consider a young man that is married. He said he is married. He knows that it's unlawful for him to take another woman. He finds himself in an awkward situation. He's alone with a woman that's not his life. His wife, the woman, is dressed provocatively. It's obvious she has other intentions. Immediately, his mind starts reasoning the process. He says to himself, I don't feel good about this in my conscience. Should I do this? If I talk to her, could it lead to something else? What state of mind is she in? What would be suitable conversation to have with her? Due to the lack of prayer and fasting, he feels that fleshly allurement. His mind instantly recognizes that it's there and screams into the heart, spirit, and very soul of his being to be careful. That's that conscience speaking. He must now make a decision, and it must be made quick. Just think about that. You find yourself in a position. This is just an example this morning. And you know, there's numerous things that we find ourselves in a place that we have to make a decision. Do I do this? I know it's wrong. Or do I go the other way? We wrestle that within our mind. The conscience says no. Then the flesh says yes. The enemy says yes. And then you got God pulling. Amen. You see the pull this morning? It's always there, isn't it? That pull. Amen. That fight. And due to the lack of prayer, if we don't pray, we're still talking about prayer this morning. The lack of seeking God, of having that power with God. Amen. That's when many men make the wrong decision. Because the devil's got more power in their mind than God does. Amen. His mind instantly recognizes it. Must be careful. He must now make a decision. It must be made quick. He does not need to rely upon his heart, his emotions, to make this decision. Because his heart, the Bible says, is deceitful. Amen. It'll lie to him. He does not need to linger. He does not need to listen to his flesh. A million thoughts are going through his mind. What should he do? In this instant this morning, think about yourself. You may find yourself in a place where there is sin presented to you and you have the decision to go that away or can go God's way. What is it that you do? If this man came into the situation with anything less than a pure mind, he is in grave danger. Amen. The answer is simple this morning. Just walk away. Praise God. If we would get a hold of that this morning, to learn to do that, to just simply walk away, it would save us all kinds of problems, all kinds of heartache, no doubt. If we learned that concept, to just walk away. It's as simple as that may sound. A mind that is clouded with the world and is in its droppings will make a terrible decision, leading the person into a horrible place. It's hard to believe that a simple decision like walking away could become so hard to make. But look around this morning. Amen. Look around in this world. Many are making foolish decisions every day. I hope you'll get a hold of this morning. Amen. People forfeiting powerful ministries, wonderful marriages by having less than a pure mind. Amen. Every day we're faced with 1,000 similar situations. Perhaps not as gross or obvious as this example I read to you this morning, but things that require a right decision. And do we have the power to make the right decision? Amen. Praise God. Go ahead.
Describe through Scripture that place that we come to in our walk with God that many, you know, fall away at. And I think that place is has to do a lot with the infilling of the Holy Ghost. And we've got a lot of people in the church world today that are living without Spirit. Not spirit filled. That's the key element.
Right.
To successfully serving God.
Amen.
Filled with the Spirit.
Yes, yes.
I know before I was filled with the Holy Ghost, I can remember I would always come to a ceiling. That was it. As far as I could go.
Right.
Until that glorious morning that God filled me. Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Like it opened a whole different world.
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir.
And when we find ourselves battling over problems all the time, and this lady spoke about that merry-go-round.
Yeah.
That is why people can't get off the merry-go-round, is because they're not living a spirit-filled life.
Right. That's right. Amen.
And the Holy Ghost.
No,
we need the Holy Ghost.
Yes, we do.
It's plain to see through the Scripture that it is the third person of Godhead and how it meant for us to be filled with His Spirit, the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And that should be walking around with us every day. That is our leader. That is our guide.
Yes.
And you know, I know that I don't believe in that. You know, you'll go to hell if you don't have the Holy Ghost. Can't be saved, but there is a place God has made available to us to go further in Him and to grow spiritually,
yeah,
and to have a spirit-filled life.
Right.
That way we don't just come to a ceiling spiritually.
Right.
And we burn out and, you know, it seems like we come to an end with our walk with God.
Yeah.
And it will always be that way until we're filled with the Holy Ghost.
Yes, sir.
You were filled with the Spirit of God.
Ah.
And 1 Timothy, this is chapter 1, said that thing that I had committed unto you. I may not be saying this word for the Scripture, but it says it's kept by the power of the Holy Ghost. So we are given, our life is given, our walk with God is given, the salvation that we have, it's insulated.
Right.
It's protected.
Yeah.
By the power of the Holy Ghost.
Right.
So what I'm trying to say here is let's press through in this prayer life. That prayer life will lead to a spirit-filled life.
Right.
Where we are kept insulated by the power of the Holy Ghost, and we're not just falling away.
Right.
Yes. And Brother Terry was speaking this morning about some guys that went to the program and just give it all up nearly the last day. Like, man, why would you waste all that time? Well, why would we waste all these years serving God?
Right.
And come to a place in our life that we're not spirit-filled.
Yes, sir.
I'm filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, and that's what we're missing.
That's what we're missing.
That's what we're missing. We need to be filled with the power of God.
Amen.
And that's what's going to help us walk this road.
Amen.
All
right. I will have that power this morning, won't you?
Amen. Just like you said, that's exactly where, you know, we're teaching about prayer and praying. That's where it leads. Amen. That leads on into the Holy Ghost. And we may get there in these lessons talking about it, but just a little bit here and all. You'll give me a few more minutes if you would wrap this up. Talking about every day we are faced with thousands of situations, and you know, but requires a right decision. And in our minds, we cannot let sin linger in our minds, can we? No. I always think about the illustration Daddy always said, you know, the bird can fly over, but don't let him build no nest there. Let him keep on flying. Amen. Don't let that thing that enters the mind build a nest in my mind, but let it keep on going. Amen. We cannot meditate, ponder, nor contemplate sin more than a moment. Amen. None. Praise God. If the mind reflects upon the seed of temptation for very long, it will spring forth roots. Praise God. And will be conceived within the heart. Ultimately, it will bring death to the soul. 2 Corinthians 10 and 5 says, casting down imaginations, every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. The only way to apprehend or capture the very thought of the mind is to fill it with prayer this morning. Amen. In God's holy word. That's how we do it. Praise God. Do you see this morning the power of a life of prayer? I hope you see how valuable this would be to our lives, to this world around us, to this man, this illustration this morning that we talked about. His mind would be led by the Spirit. His thoughts would be clear. Do you see how valuable this would be in our marriages this morning? If we have that life of prayer, if we have that pure mind this morning, that when these temptations do come, and trust me, they will. Amen. Do we have the pure mind? Do we have the power to walk away? To make the right decision? That we don't cause destruction? We've all made wrong decisions, haven't we? I have. I'll be the first to admit that. Amen. But you know what? I don't have to make them again, do I? Amen. I don't have to be in that place again. Praise God. Make up your mind this morning that, hey, I'm going to have the prayer life, read God's word like I should, and have the power of God indwelling with me that I can overcome those temptations. Because like I said last Sunday, the devil knows your weakness. The devil knows where he can get you at. Praise God, but you can fool him this morning. Amen. He don't have to get us, does he? We must have a life of prayer. Praise God. Pray. Pray when you feel like it. Pray when you don't feel like it. You never know when a situation might come up on you unaware and it call for a quick resolution. Do you have the power to overcome this morning? Ask yourself that. Do I have the power to overcome? Do I have the power within me? Amen. That I can go out of these doors this morning if I'm faced with a situation that I can say no. Amen. It'd be good for all of us to search our hearts. Praise God that we have that power. If you have a pure mind, you must make it your goal in life to pray always. If you do this, amen, that's the way you avoid falling. Amen. This man here, he said, I often think about my grandparents, my grandmother. He said especially, there were many times he was awoken by the sound, of prayer. Her praying for her children and for her grandchildren. They prayed in the morning. They knelt at every meal. They prayed every night before they went to bed. He said it recalls hearing her whispering, Jesus, 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 over and over. He said, as a young man, a lost young man at that, I could never understand why she did this. As we traveled in the car, she would look out the window and whisper under her breath, Jesus, Jesus. I know she prayed without ceasing because he said, I literally heard her praying. The whisper of Jesus' name was audible, but it was only an outward expression of something that I could not see in her heart. Amen. She continually called his name because he was continually upon her mind. Amen. It shows what's continual upon our minds, don't it? God help me this morning, amen, to have him continually on my mind. Amen, to continually have a life of prayer. Praise God. Amen. We got to have it, church. Amen. It's not an option this morning. If we're going to make it, praise God, we got to have a life of prayer.
Amen.
If we're going to have the power to overcome, we got to have a life of prayer. Amen. Let's stand this morning.